The Rubicon, starring Jeremy Winston, in 3, 2, 1.
Okay, you're on again with Jeremy Winston. This is the Rubicon. I have Dr. Jason Ferdinand, the director of choral activities at Oakwood University in Huntsville, Alabama. I'm very happy to have him on. How you doing, Jason?
Doing great, man. How you doing, Jeremy?
Doing well. I just want to tell our listeners that Jason and I are former classmates at Oakwood. I mean, of course, his official title is Dr. Ferdinand, so forgive me.
Jason is fine.
Okay. All right. I won't presume anything, yeah. You know, but, great to have him on. And I just want to chat briefly, to talk about, some of his inspirations in music and, some of his goals and things that he has been able to achieve, as the director of choral activities at Oakwood University. And correct me if I'm wrong anytime, but that includes being the director of the Oakwood College Aeolians, as well as the Oakwood College Choir. And he is also the Minister of Music at Oakwood College Church. Is all that correct?
That's correct, except for the college part.
Oh, okay.
We're going back to our days. They switched to university. They get
right,
real picky about that.
Yeah, let me tell you something. So a couple years ago, you all came to Ethan Temple here in Dayton, Ohio, and I closed out the service and I offered prayer and I said Oakwood College at some point during that. And then the students told me, say, yeah, you're just showing your age when you say Oakwood College. I mean, it's hard to believe that now the preferred Oakwood College is so old school that they reveal your age, but I guess it's the truth. So, you know,
it is the truth, man.
Yeah. So Jason, tell us a little bit about, what led you, to go into music and ultimately led you at Oakwood University to be the course director.
Oh man, I'll give it a short version. I'm trying to go back in my mind when I was not doing music. I think I've been doing music all my life. Elementary school, we always had those children's choir, and I just thought it was something everybody did.
Right.
And, did it all through elementary school, and in Trinidad we had like groups. We had a vocal sextet group for many, many years that we tried to copy ourselves, copy Take Six and what they were doing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I went through high school, and in the British system, we had to choose our life's work kind of early. So I went into sciences at that point. And after traditional high school, we have this thing called advanced levels where you choose three topics. And then everyone has to do a thing called general paper, which mm-hmm. is like a writing thing. So my subjects were biology, chemistry, and physics. So at that point, I was thinking I was going to head to med school. But all along this time, I was still doing music heavily. Royal Schools of Music theory exams, Royal School of Music practical piano.
Mm-hmm.
Now I think of it, at one point I was conducting the college choir, even though I wasn't even in college. That's
oh, wow.
A really long story. Yeah, but I think the turning point for me really was I was kind of like on the doorstep of going to med school, and one night I just said, you know what, I was doing really well in the sciences, but I just wasn't enjoying it. I mean, I was just kind of going through the motions.
Mm-hmm.
I got tired of explaining what photosynthesis was and the glycolysis cycle, 36 ATPs. It was the same thing all along, just kind of build. I was like, this is no fun. But I was really having fun doing music. So I remember telling my parents the next morning after that night of revelation, I was like, you know what, I really think I want to do music. And surprisingly, now I look back at it, my parents were not opposed at all. Now I have to kind of explain that. You know, West Indian home, you know, saying you're going into music is not really a choice in life, unless you're doing mm-hmm. calypso or soca or something like that. And being at Seventh-day Adventist totally knocked that out.
right.
But I think my dad and my mom are both educators, so I think they at that point they kind of knew the harm that would be placed on me if they opposed and I was doing something I didn't want to do. So at that point, they just sorted that I go to Adventist school. I had a great music program. So that's how I ended up coming to Oakwood. in 97. Mm-hmm. And so I think that was a turning point. I just wanted to do something that I really enjoyed and that didn't seem like work. So that's how I ended up going to music. So came to college there, and then, you know, you know our professor there, Dr. Mallory,
right,
a graduate of Morgan State. And even before I came to Oakwood, I knew about Morgan State because we had those old VHS tapes, aging myself again. And,
right.
So I knew Dr. Carter and his work, and through Lloyd, I kind of linked up with Dr. Carter, and he took me as a graduate assistant, and this would be 1999. So kind of went there, had 2 years of, you know, those 2 years were pivotal. I mean, you know that you're a graduate of Dr. Carter's as well.
Mm-hmm,
but
mm-hmm.
Those years were pivotal, and it really influenced a lot of what I do every day now. I don't think there's a day that goes by, but I don't think of what would Dr. Carter do right now. You know what I mean?
Like, right. Oh, yeah,
yeah. Yeah, I kind of go through those motions. So I left Morgan, went to Pine Forge Academy as choir director there for 7 years. And along the way, the call came from Oakwood to come down and join the team down here. That would be 2008, I believe. Yeah, 2008. So I've kind of been at Oakwood ever since, you know, just trying to continue the great tradition that's been handed down, man.
Outstanding. You listen to Dr. Jason Ferdinand on the Rubicon with Jeremy Winston. We're going to take a brief break.
Arise and give God glory. This is the command of gospel artist Kimberly Bolgen. She commands everyone to give God praise in her hit single entitled Garment of Praise.
Now is the time for your
This song gives a bold command to praise God no matter what. Continue to praise God as you also enjoy Kimberly Bolgen's other hit single entitled, God Chose Me.
God chose me.
Put on your garment of praise with gospel artist Kimberly Bolgen and experience a new level of praise and worship. Check out our download locations to purchase gospel artist Kimberly Bolgen's music. You can also find out more about Kimberly Bolgen on her website at KimberlyBolgen.com. Experience the power of God through the dynamic ministry of Kimberly Bolgen today.
In 49 BC, Julius Caesar led an army over the Rubicon River from Gaul into northern Italy. By doing so, he crossed the point of no return in declaration of war against the Roman Empire. Centuries later, you are listening to Jeremy Winston reach his point of no return only on Advent Sports, The Rubicon.
So Oakwood, initially, I wanted to be a composition major, and for whatever reason, they stopped the program at that point, and then as soon as I left, they brought it back. But up to that point, I was pretty much arranging, like, all the time in Trinidad. Like I mentioned, we had this little Take Six group, and my friends and I would be in, like, friendly competition to see who could come up with the best arrangements. Like, we'll just pick the same songs and
nice.
Find out who could come up with the best arrangement. Was like a weekly thing at one point.
Right.
Now that my kind of school work is kind of done, I'm kind of now slowly getting back into that arranging grind. So to answer your question, where do I get the inspiration from? I mean, it comes from different places at different times, man. Sometimes I'll read something, I'll hear a certain text, not biblical text, just, you know, just words, mm-hmm. and that will spark something. Or sometimes I could just be sitting in church, listening to a sermon or a speech or something just kind of sparks, or some life events or something. So it comes from different places at different times. I don't know that I have one source, but the actual sitting down to put it together, I think that piece just kind of comes from, you know, just a lot of experience on the keyboard and just trying to keep up with the latest trends and harmonies and the way we use all those tools. So at that point, it becomes more, you know, what am I going to use for this portrait or this painting? So
right.
The inspiration comes from some many different places, sometimes the most expectant of places. Prefixes things actually came from, I walked into a rehearsal one day and the students were having devotion and I couldn't even tell you what the person was talking about, but I literally just kind of stood there listening to them and I kind of had a germ of the idea from years before, but I kind of just put the whole thing back together again right then. So that clip, I think, was us just singing right after that tour. That's how that perfect system is happening. I'm just kind of really shocked that I got so many emails about people trying to have to get the music. And at that point, I hadn't even scored it yet.
So, right.
You know, that's a good example of it. Just kind of comes, and I just taught it by rote, and the actual scoring and tweaking kind of came after. Yeah.
Wow. Well, this is tremendous. Again, you're listening to Dr. Jason Ferdinand, director of the Oakwood University Aeolians and Oakwood University Choir, as well as the Minister of Music for Oakwood University Church. Got to get all that Oakwood University out there. Just kind of say it over and over so it becomes natural. Hey, listen, right. One last question. So, I mean, you know that we all know that Aeolians have a history of of great choral music. I know that it has a star on the Hall of Fame for Alabama, and with all the directors, there have been, you know, high points for each director, and each director has kind of made give his or her own stamp to this course. And so my question to you have a very unique and powerful sound that comes from Aeolians. What are some of your approaches musically? And this may be a question for all the musicians out there listening in. What are some of your approaches that gets your very clean, very precise, very accurate sound in your choral music?
How do I answer that question? Well, let me say this first. I've noticed over the years that the world's greatest musicians kind of have a facility to make music with the inordinate, I guess, religious devotion. It seems self-sacrificing and self-critical, emulating dedication. They seem to always have a propulsive drive. I mean, you go through the list of Robert Shaw and all these giants. And they have this staunch conviction. So I've tried to adopt that, man, and just really been studying, like, choral approaches, choral techniques, or what's the latest trends. You know, that's the part of the job people don't see. But I really just try to stay on top of what's new. And, you know, being a member of the American Choral Directors Association, you kind of get a glimpse of what not just different choirs are doing, but different regions. And I think a region that's really affected me has been the choirs out in the West Coast. They seem to have a really different choral swag.
Right.
If I could use that word. You know, they seem to mix, and again, this is just me talking now. They seem to mix really solid choral techniques and traditions, and depending on the song, they sneak in some jazz influences and some pop. And so it's kind of like everything coming together, all with good technique. I need to keep underlining that. So for me, I'm just always trying to find what's new, what's relevant, or how can we make our programming more diverse. You know, I get bored very quickly. So, you know, I sit there with the program, I think, okay, how can I change this up for a listener who could just always be in an element of surprise? So, you know, little things like starting to integrate video things to concerts and auditory things besides the singing, and I just wanted new techniques. And West Coast, I remember back in 2006, I think it was, I was at the University of Maryland Chamber Singers, and we went out to Wales to the Estafet, the choir competition out there. You know, we got to hear choirs from literally all over the world. The choir that won the title that year was a group out on the West Coast, and University of Maryland, we kept coming second in every category with them, like by 1 point, 2 points. But this choir just seemed to have this different thing, and I noticed it was just the facial expressions on a whole other level, and just move into the music. And I remember having a conversation with the director just to kind of figure out what was going on. Because, you know, for those of us who at that point were kind of traditionalists, you know, we just stand there and sing, we kind of all felt, oh, man, this looks so Hollywood and so California. And like, what is that doing?
Right.
But when I spoke to him, I really realized that there was a reason to everything he did. It was connected some kind of way to the music. So, you know, so it was after that, and I came to Oakwood, and I said, you know what, man, I'm just going to try doing some of my own things. And, of course, people see something different. You know, you'll have those who hate it. And,
right.
Or they learn to appreciate it after. And that's fine. I think that's part of our jobs as educators, too.
I was just about to say the same thing. I mean, you're an educator, so you're teaching right. people to appreciate new things. Exactly.
Right. I'm gonna cook this new dish. I'm gonna bring it to the table, and it's your choice if you like it or not.
So right.
That's kind of been my approach, man. Just trying to be bold. I think as a musician, you have to be bold and realize that not everybody's gonna like everything you do. I think I learned that lesson when I was 8. So I've never had that struggle about, oh man, I don't think they're gonna like this, you know. So I think the key to the students here really embraced all the new, you know, quote unquote new things. And students now, this generation coming up, you know, they're very different than we were.
Right.
So they like introducing video and like introducing this and that. So in a way, I'm trying to keep up with them because, you know, we can't force the stuff they struggle to embrace. I mean, you know, what's the point of, I had a discussion with a student, it was just yesterday, actually. This student was in grad school, and she was saying, you know, it's kind of funny. They have her just regurgitating theories from dead people, mm-hmm. and she never has a chance to express her views and her current views. And I think that's part of education, too. We have to allow them to feel like they are part of creating, as opposed right. to just learning and memorizing some theory from some dead person. So that's a long answer to your question, man. Just trying to stay on the forefront of what's going on.
Well, I tell you, I just want to second that last point you made. I mean, being a musician, you are creating. I mean, that's what, at least you're right, we are at our best. Musicians are at their best. Artists are at their best. And quite frankly, I think most humans are at their best when they're creating, when they're learning what they're pulling from the information that they were given early on, and then they're right. synthesizing the information that they have presently, and then they're coming to some different conclusion, and they're producing a result that is beneficial
right.
today. I think all of that is important. Listen, you've been on the Rubicon with Jeremy Winston. We've been talking to Dr. Jason Ferdinand, the Director of Choral Activities at Oakwood University and the Minister of Music at Oakwood University Church. Hey, Jason, thanks for being on.
Thanks, man. My pleasure. Take care.
The Rubicon is an ASN Talk Radio expansion franchise about current events, news, and geopolitics. All footage is taped in Dayton, Ohio, and produced at Advent Sports Network's downtown studios in the lovely Emerald City of Seattle, Washington.